good afternoon, everyone. We are very excited to welcome you to this virtual teacher workshop, Confederate Monuments and Memorialization from the Maryland Center for History and Culture. Really appreciate you spending some of your Saturday here with us to learn about this very important topic. So I will go ahead and introduce myself first. My name is David Armenti. I'm the Director of Education at the Maryland Center for History and Culture.
My name is Alex Lawstein. I am the Museum Learning Manager, also at the Maryland Center for History and Culture.
And we are both members of the Education Programs team, where we provide service to not only our K-12 audiences, but adult learners as well. So a bit about the Maryland Center for History and Culture before we get started. So the organization was originally founded in 1844. So we've recently celebrated our 175th anniversary. And being one of the oldest cultural institutions in Maryland, but we officially rebranded in September of 2020. So now you know us as MCHC, but it had formerly been the Maryland Historical Society for 175 years. And being around for that long, one of the greatest advantages that we have are our collections. So we will talk a little bit about our education programming today, but mostly we're going to be focusing on the historical context as well as the primary source material from the H. Furlong Baldwin Library, as well as the museum collection, which amounts to about 7 million documents and over 300,000 objects. So an incredible collection for us to draw from, particularly for topics like this that can be challenging to really analyze. But through our programming and through our interpretation, we're covering Maryland history as well as the national context, looking at the period of indigenous nations here in Maryland and the Chesapeake coming up through the modern era. And as an education department, we offer a variety of experiences. Again, a few of that we'll touch on a little bit toward the end, including on-site field trips at the museum. You can see the front there behind me virtually, as well as traveling chunks that go to the classroom, virtual field trips where we beam into the classroom or to the home, as well as digital online curriculum through the historical investigations portal. So before we transition into the content, I do just want to mention that all of our public programming, as well as our professional development, comes to you free, and we are very happy to be able to provide that to our different audiences and the public. But also, considering that this programming is free, know that we really do rely on the support of educators, members, and others. So consider joining as a member, check out our other public programs when you get a chance, and we will definitely hint at some of the other really relevant programming that's coming up in the near future. But with all that said, I'm going to kick it over to Alex to get us started talking about some of this historical context around monuments and memorialization.
Great. Thanks, David. So today, this presentation is going to be broken up into three different topics: the post-Civil War memorialization, music, and then memory and activism today regarding monuments. So just a little bit of background. As you can see by this map, Maryland is a border state. Well, it was a border state, I should say, north of Virginia, south of Pennsylvania. It was a slave state, but it was one of the most northern slave states in the United States. During the Civil War, Maryland fights for the Union, and it is Baltimore is under martial law for most of the Civil War. Due to a lot of Confederate sympathies that are in Maryland at that time. But like I said, Maryland was a slave state. So this is a map using census data from 1860. And as you can see, the gold numbers are gonna be the free population, so the free Black population. The white numbers are gonna be the enslaved population. So as you can see, Prince George's County has about over 12,000 enslaved individuals. It is the largest. It has the largest number of enslaved individuals in Maryland, mostly one because a lot of tobacco plantations are down there. It's also next to Virginia and Alexandria, Virginia, which is one of the biggest enslaved ports in the United States at the time. But another thing to notice is that Baltimore City has 25,000 or over 25,000 free blacks living in the city. It had the largest free population of any southern city in the United States. The benefit or one thing about Maryland is it was just south of Pennsylvania, which was a free state, which led to a lot of enslaved individuals running away to Pennsylvania. Harriet Tubman, Frederick Douglass are some of the key individuals from Maryland. This is a great map. One thing to notice though, is if you look at Allegheny County all the way in Western Maryland, it has a very small enslaved population, primarily due to the economy being based around mining, lumber, and other types of iron works. In Maryland, enslaved individuals are going to be mostly on the Eastern Shore or Southern Maryland. So when we look at the Civil War in Maryland, Maryland was a slave state and a border state. As I said, there was a large amount of support for the Confederacy in Maryland. We see that during the Pratt Street Riot, and the first bloodshed of the Civil War took place on April 19th, 1861. In Baltimore during the Pratt Street Riots. A little bit of background on that, Massachusetts troops are making their way to Washington, DC. They have to disembark from a train and make their way over to another train, and they're attacked by a mob as they're marching through along Pratt Street. As a result, President Lincoln suspends the writ of habeas corpus in Maryland, placing Maryland under martial law. And then James Rattle Randall, writes Maryland, My Maryland, which is now the state song. We're going to talk about that a little bit later. But I do want to go back and say, in terms of popular support for the Confederacy, Chief Justice Robert Taney was from Maryland, and he supported, was the Chief Justice during the Dred Scott case, which basically said Black individuals are not citizens of the United States. And also the Maryland legislature and the local government officials, many local government officials were pro-Confederate in Maryland. Maryland had about 60,000 men fight for the Union and about 20,000 fight for the Confederacy. Most of the regiments that were raised in Maryland were Union regiments, 8 were Confederate. Maryland did raise 6 United States Colored Troop regiments. There are 3 major battles that happened in Maryland: Antietam, Battle of South Mountain, and Monocacy. Antietam is going to lead to the Emancipation Proclamation, which ends slavery in all states in open rebellion, which doesn't include Maryland. It also allows for the recruitment of United States Colored Troop regiments. After the Civil War, with slavery abolished in 1865, it became hard for the South to justify the reasoning for the Civil War. And so this led to the Lost Cause narrative. And so these are the 6 tenets or myths of the Lost Cause narrative. And we're going to kind of address some of these today, but I just want to go through them quickly. The first one is that the Civil War was fought over secession, not slavery. You'll also sometimes hear states' rights, not slavery. The other, number 2, is that slavery was good and enslaved people were happy. We'll actually see that in one of the later monuments that we highlight. But this is something that they were trying to show, that enslaved individuals were happy and they wanted to work in the work on the plantations. The third one is the Confederacy was only defeated because of lack of resources and manpower. That's a very common one, and one that many people actually think is true. Confederate soldiers were fighting for an honorable cause and are heroic or saintly, and we'll see that a lot in monuments. That shows up a lot in monuments. Confederate leaders and generals were portrayed as saints, martyrs, and symbols of courage, and had statues built. Again, we'll see that later on. And then number 6 is that Southern women were pure and sacrificed their sons, brothers, and husbands for the cause. And so what we'll see in a later statue is that you see a lot of angels, especially female angels, who are signifying that saintly Southern womanhood. So Lost Cause narrative began immediately after the Civil War and was spread by Southern women. Between 1865 and 1932, Southern veteran organizations like Sons of Confederate Veterans, historical societies and magazines all pushed the Lost Cause movement. The Lost Cause grew as Jim Crow laws spread as well, and Lost Cause became statues and monuments. And then what's interesting is that the time period of the rise in monuments and the growth of lost cause also coincided with the increasing violence against Black people and Black Marylanders as well, through lynchings or other racial terror means. As you can see, about 40 lynchings, at least 40 lynchings occurred in Maryland.
And I should also mention, we are seeing a little engagement in the chat. You are welcome to, first of all, if you'd like to announce who you are and where you're coming from for us and the rest of the participants, you can do that in the chat. Also, again, reminder for those that came in a little later that as we're in a webinar, your audio and video are disabled, but we will take questions in the chat, also in the Q&A, which you can see in the bottom of your screen. So feel free to put your questions in. We will try to address as much as we can through the course of the program, but we are here for just an hour. So we will do our best to get to your questions as well as through our content. So I do want to talk a bit about curriculum, the ways that curriculum has effectively addressed, or some of the limitations when we're looking at not only Confederate monuments memorialization, but the necessary context before that. A report that came out recently from the Southern Poverty Law Center really identified how the addressing of American slavery within curriculum and within classrooms across America, in many cases, has been insufficient. We're really seeing that, especially as related to the Civil War, there are a large number of upper level students, in this case, high school seniors, who don't know that connection between enslavement, the institution of slavery, and the causes of the Civil War. Particularly in Maryland, that is a major theme that we want to be able to address with our students in understanding those connections. Furthermore, the issue of what you're going to be finding in textbooks. Many teachers are finding that their textbooks are inadequate in making these connections, also presenting the perspectives of people that were enslaved, or giving different understanding of what that experience was like. And that's part of the reason why institutions, cultural institutions such as ours, really need to come up and try to fill that gap in terms of other ways of learning outside of the textbook. And thinking about the actual standards related to curriculum, within this particular study of the 15 that were analyzed, there was not that direct connection between white supremacy, in the case of what we're talking about today, representations of white supremacy, or of the Confederacy and its legacy, and how that connects to the institution of slavery. Also how it connects to the Civil War itself and the efforts to commemorate it. So we all really need to be filling that gap, so to speak, and finding better ways of addressing those connections. Some of the proposals and ways that teachers and others can do this is to very, very literally make that connection between slavery and the continued progress and promotion of white supremacy as an ideology. Particularly in that post-war period, we see how this develops over time, how it strengthens in certain areas of the country. But that's not something that our students are typically going to understand readily. And often you're going to need something more than the textbook to do so. One of the things we're going to focus on today is the use of those original historical documents outside of the textbook and outside of the curriculum. So primary source material from cultural institutions such as ours will help to build up that interpretation and equip teachers to design material even themselves. So that's part of what our goal is here today. Some ready-made resources, but really a lot of primary source material that can be crafted into classroom investigations or discussions. And I'll mention, we do have a comment in the chat that this is part of the reason why Abraham Lincoln was demonized by some Americans who didn't know he couldn't totally end slavery. So that's a good time to mention the distinction between the national story and what actually happens here in Maryland, because while Lincoln did pass the put forward the Emancipation Proclamation, that only applied to the states that were in rebellion. And furthermore, that it wouldn't officially end until the amendments were passed post-war. But in Maryland, slavery wasn't actually ended until November of 1864, when the state legislature passed a new state constitution ending the institution. That's not to say that there weren't people fleeing and finding their own way to freedom, especially through service in the United States Colored Troops. But yes, we do have to make those distinctions and have those direct connections too. As far as looking at Maryland, I do want to say that I think Maryland is really ahead of the curve when it comes to trying to make those connections between enslavement, the Civil War, and some of the continued legacy that we'll be talking about here today. But that being said, the explicit mention of monuments as a representation of white supremacy and segregation, mentions of the Lost Cause are almost completely absent from the frameworks that we have available to us through the Maryland State Department of Education. So there are some examples of how teachers can make those connections within curriculum. I've identified a few examples here. Fifth grade is a level, I didn't outline the bullets here, but certainly at the fifth grade level, you have students addressing the post-war period and the expansion of civil rights and efforts to restrict civil rights. That is often the way that we can find these connections within the curriculum to insert these conversations about monuments, music, and other symbols of the Confederacy and how that connects to the larger ideology. But you can see that within the eighth grade level, this is really where we expect a lot of that higher level thinking to start to come through with our students, opportunities to look at the development toward the Civil War, especially Maryland's role within that, as well as what the impact and change on society was within the United States Civil War and beyond. Reconstruction is explicitly addressed within the curriculum, or within the social studies framework, I should say, and efforts to think about how we actually reconcile from those past injustices. So this is definitely a good entry point to talk about some of those different symbols and how they connect to, as Alex was alluding to earlier, the Jim Crow era, restrictions of rights. It's not just about changing the law, but these public symbols and things that were put on public property especially were also a part of that same dynamic. High school curriculum within United States history is another great opportunity to extend that conversation. You can see how issues of post-Civil War industrialization are mentioned, and that might be a little loose of a connection, but especially when you see some of the examples that we have within the collection and images of primary sources, you can see a lot of them are oriented within urban spaces. It's not disconnected from urban redevelopment and industrialization that we're seeing within these areas. And also the efforts to not only restrict, but also to expand rights. So you have the development of the NAACP and other like organizations, even moving back into the Reconstruction period. And then you also have the backlash to that, the rise of the Ku Klux Klan and other examples of racial terror, lynching, and violence, as well as the legislative efforts to restrict the ability of African Americans and other groups within these societies to expand their own rights. And I should mention, I had the bullet there, there are some unique examples within particular school systems. I wanted to highlight that one where Baltimore City Public Schools does actually have a a middle school unit called Who Deserves a Monument within their Be More Me curriculum. So there are places throughout Maryland, possibly within your own local jurisdiction, where you can find ways, again, entry points to have these sorts of discussions around monuments, music, and other symbols. And before I jump into the using primary sources a little bit, I do see that we have some activity within the chat. Some folks were asking about that map that you featured earlier, Alex, which is a really wonderful source that displays the census data. That is not in the document package that we made available to everyone, but if you want to follow up on a particular source or resource that you see within the slides, definitely feel free to connect with us after the workshop. But as far as using primary sources, this is going to be a major focus of the rest of the presentation is how do you take this raw material and make it useful within the classroom? And we'll be interested to hear from you all as well. But using primary sources really brings history to life. It activates that learning as opposed to students just passively absorbing information. And it's a way to address different types of learners. So we really feel like it's such a valuable resource when you're able to bring those primary accounts into the classroom. So that's what we're going to be spending much of the rest of our time on here today, is featuring items from our collection and others, many of which were made available to you within the package.
So when we're going to start by looking at post-Civil War memorialization. And as I put images up and picture the statues, I'm going to be like asking questions, but these are in a sense just to get you to think about how you might use these sources in your classroom. If you do have a thought, feel free to put it in the chat. But I will be kind of asking questions, but then also kind of answering how David and I might use these when we're working with students. So in terms of post-war memorialization, we kind of have it down into four different areas: immediate post-war, the lost cause emergence, memorials in the South, and memorials to Black Americans, veterans, or other. But I want to start with this image right here. This is an image. It's kind of hard to tell who's in it, and students have a lot of problems trying to figure out what's going on. But for those who are familiar with Baltimore, you might notice that the battle monument is highlighted on the right side. A little bit of background, this is a stereo view from 1870 of a parade taking place in Baltimore to honor the passage of the 15th Amendment. The group is primarily Black Baltimoreans who started the parade at the Battle Monument and then marched up past the Washington Monument in Mount Vernon. And what's interesting is following the Civil War, immediately after, use of monuments took the form of centers of celebration in the North. You had a lot of people gather at monuments for celebrations to celebrate the end of the war. You had a lot of people, such as many Black Baltimoreans, gather to celebrate the passage of the 15th Amendment. In the former Confederate states, though, monuments weren't really there. There weren't any major monuments. No one gathered around monuments to celebrate. But what's starting to happen is people are starting to look at how can they rewrite the war. And this began to emerge during Reconstruction. But Reconstruction kind of put a stop to the celebration of Confederate leaders. The Union commanders in the South didn't allow monuments to go up. And they halted the celebration and the rewriting of history. But what I want to start, and one important thing to note, is that Robert E. Lee, after the war, swore allegiance to the Union. He believed that the Confederacy or the former Confederate states should move on, but he specifically opposed Confederate monuments. And that's important to realize, because what we'll find out later is a lot of monuments were put up to Robert E. Lee, but he specifically opposed monuments going up. After the war, when we talk about memory, for many Confederate veterans, early memory of the Civil War manifested itself into relic room similar to the one you see here. This is a photo from 1898 of the relic room at the Maryland Line Confederate Soldiers Home, which was here in Maryland, up near Towson, I believe. The facility that became the Maryland Line Confederate Soldiers Home dates back to 1818 when it was a federal arsenal. But then in 1888, it was converted to a residence for soldiers who served in the Confederacy during the Civil War, and it remained open until 1932. But when we look at this image, we see symbols of the Confederacy, symbols that promote the enslavement of people of color. We also see busts and monuments. We would use this in our education program to highlight the type of memory used by soldiers of the Confederacy following the Civil War. So this draws the question of, this is a private space. Is memory in a private space okay? Despite the same iconography as later Confederate monuments, does this differ from statues in public spaces? And that's an interesting thing that we like to discuss with students, is how is memory, when is memory allowed, or where should it be allowed, right? This is a private building, this is a private room. Are these symbols allowed in that room? But if we took this room and put it in a public space, would that be allowed? And this is something that we'd like to get students to think about, because it gets them thinking about, where does memory exist? Where does memorialization exist, and where should it exist? So going into the timeline, some of the first monuments to go up after the Civil War were those oriented towards soldiers and regiments who fought in the war. Many of these monuments, like the one seen here at Culp's Hill at Gettysburg Battlefield, were erected by the soldiers who were part of these regiments. This is actually a photo from 1894 of veterans from the 2nd Maryland Infantry Regiment who fought for the Confederate States. Many of these monuments were put up to recognize unit locations on battlefields or in graveyards to commemorate the dead. This monument is one of many at Gettysburg National Battlefield that is overseen and maintained by the National Park Service. And so when you visit battlefields from the Civil War, you're going to find these monuments all over the place, to Union soldiers, to Confederate soldiers. There are monuments all throughout, sprinkled in major battlefields. And so we like to have students think about, what are some ways this can be used to explain memory and memorialization after the Civil War? Is this commemorating the Lost Cause movement, or is this commemorating the soldiers who died? Is this promoting the ideals of the Confederacy, or is this just a remembrance from people who lost friends and colleagues that they were fighting next to? Some people they might've fought with for years. But what's an interest, and once we get students to think about that, we also like to get them to think, is this a justifiable monument being, is this a justifiable monument despite being a Confederate monument? Is it justifiable to have a monument to soldiers from a Confederate regiment who died at Gettysburg up in a public space? Does this promote the Lost Cause? Does this promote racism? And so this is what we want students to think about when we show them this image. And it's not just Confederate monuments that are going up after the war, almost immediately after the war. This is a monument to Colonel Robert Gould Shaw and the Massachusetts 54th Regiment. I should note that when this was put up, it was called the Colonel Robert Gould Shaw Memorial. He was the white commander of the 54th Massachusetts Regiment, which was one of the first Black regiments from the North to serve in the Civil War. Later, it has been, I think the name has changed to the Colonel Robert Gould Shaw and Massachusetts 54th Regiment Memorial to incorporate the story of the Black United States Colored Troops who fought. But this was put up in Boston. The 54th Massachusetts Volunteer Infantry, they helped overcome public opposition to Black soldiers. And they became very famous in the movie Glory, which is based around the battle at Fort Wagner. This monument was built in 1884. And so this was put up to Shaw with the 54th in the background. But what's interesting is, when you look at this, despite being a monument to a United States Colored Troop Regiment, it does have a white savior motif with it, right? Robert Gould Shaw is on a horse in front of USCT troops. Like I said, today it is viewed as a monument to Black soldiers. But when we talk about where monuments should exist, this isn't at Fort Wagner, it's not in South Carolina, but it is in Boston. And that's where the regiment was raised. So do monuments in cities where regiments are raised, are they okay? Yes, this is a union monument, but what if this was a monument to the 2nd Maryland Regiment if they in Baltimore where they were raised? Would that make sense? So where monuments are placed, we also want students to think about how does that affect the meaning of a monument? So the actions of the 54th, their enlistment inspired nearly 200,000 African Americans to join the US military and fight during the Civil War. But coming back to Baltimore, in Baltimore, some of the first Confederate monuments to go up were the Confederate Soldiers and Sailors Monument and the Confederate Monument at Loudoun Park Cemetery. The Soldiers and Sailors Monument is the one on the left of the screen. The Confederate Monument at Loudoun Park Cemetery is on the right of the screen. The one at Loudoun Park Cemetery was sculpted by Frederick Volk in 1870, and it has a Confederate soldier standing above some young children, possibly cherubs, and a subsection of the cemetery has been federally owned since 1961. And it holds the remains of about 2,000 Union soldiers and about 650 Confederate soldiers killed during the American Civil War. On the left side, we have the Confederate Soldiers and Sailors Monument, which is located in the Mount Royal Avenue, in the Bolton Hill neighborhood of Baltimore. This sculpture depicts Glory, an angel holding up a dying Confederate soldier with her right hand while raising a wreath in her left hand. It was originally installed in 1903. The statue was removed in 2017, along with other Confederate monuments by the city after a unanimous vote. But similar to battlefields, these monuments are dedicated to the soldiers and sailors of the Confederate Army and Navy, but instead of being on battlefields, you can see they're in a city. Although one is at a cemetery, the other is on a street that had no connection to the Civil War, besides the fact that a lot of former Confederate soldiers lived in Bolton Avenue or Bolton Hill. And so this draws the question, what place do Confederate monuments commemorating the dead and those who fought have in the public? One is put up on a cemetery, one is on a road. They're both very public, but one commemorates dead at a graveyard. So is that okay versus the one that is just put up on a public street that many people walk by? What questions would you ask your students? How would you have them compare these two and the stories behind them? One question we might ask is, are these more justifiable than a statue of a Confederate leader? And then one thing is, when we talk about these monuments going up, how would we use this in the larger debate? Because we are going to get to the larger Robert E. Lee statues, the Lee Jackson Memorial that's in Baltimore, or that was in Baltimore. But these smaller ones, how do they tie into that debate? And one thing that I wanna add and share is, this is we see the prayer that went with the commemoration when the statue was first put up in 1903, the prayer that went with it. Just because a monument was dedicated to soldiers doesn't mean that it was not designed with lost cause mentality, especially those not at battlefields and cemeteries. A lot that were put up, even though they had a commemorating soldiers who died, still had a lost cause lean to them, as you can see in the last two sentences. So like I said, this is the opening prayer of the celebration. The last two sentences state Confederate soldiers were able to discern a righteous cause and hear the truth. Also note that the statue they say that they put country above self. So it's commemorating the whole idea of the Confederacy rather than the soldiers. And it's saying that what the Confederacy was fighting for was a righteous cause and the truth. This statue is put, like I said, in a state where there are more Union soldiers than Confederate. There are more Black Baltimoreans than in many Southern cities. So how do you think a statue like this would affect Black Baltimoreans when it was going up? And then how does this challenge the idea that these were just memorials to soldiers? Is this a monument to a soldier, or is it a monument to the Confederate cause? And that's where it gets tricky with some of these. It might not say anything on it, but when you look at the people who paid to put it up, like the chaplain of the Daughters of the Confederacy in the state of Maryland who did this prayer, you can see that it does have that lost cause lean to it. So now we're going to jump to a statue of Confederate generals. This is the monument depicting Confederate generals Stonewall Jackson and Robert E. Lee. It was formerly located on the west side of Wyman Park, Dell, and Baltimore. It was designed in 1948, and it was an interesting fact, the first double equestrian statue in the United States. But it was a double equestrian statue of Robert E. Lee and Stonewall Jackson, who had no connection to Maryland besides passing through the state during the war. And when this statue was put up in 1948, Baltimore had seen a boom in its Black population as defense workers made their way to Baltimore looking for jobs during World War II. And so how does the growth of the Black population of Baltimore coincide with this statue? This is a great example to use in classes as it highlights the roles that statues played in promoting the lost cause, even in cities that were not part of the Confederacy. It's also one of the farthest north statues of a Confederate leader. Another interesting thing, and one thing that we would use with students, is how does it look with the two white boys looking up at Confederate generals? What opinion might they get? How would the reaction be different if this was African American children? What would you use with this monument with this picture to discuss this within your classroom? And as you can see, it's not just a monument to the generals. You can see the text that is around it. You can say that they were great generals and Christian soldiers and waged war like gentlemen. They, you know, advanced to the execution of my purpose. You can see, so they're again putting and saying that they were great Christian soldiers and waged warlike gentlemen, saying that they were honorable, trying to make them seem saintly. Remember we said that one of the lost cause tenets was to make people seem saintly. I should note that this statue was removed in 2017 per the order from the Baltimore City Council, along with other Confederate monuments. The base of the statue is still there, but the surrounding area has been renamed Harriet Tubman Grove. So how would that affect how you would use this in your classroom? The renaming, would that, would you look at that as a Band-Aid, or would you look at that as a changing of who's being honored? One of the most famous statues of Robert Lee is actually in Richmond. And we'll talk about it a little bit later when we get to memory today. But this is a medallion featuring Confederate General Robert E. Lee. It hung from a brass eagle pin. On October 27, 1887, the city of Richmond, the capital of the Confederacy, held a ceremony for the laying of the first stone of the monument to Lee. Pieces of the statue were built in several places, and then they were brought together in 1890, and they were put up. When using the source, one thing I would want to highlight is the eagle. This eagle is a symbol of the United States. It has the crest of the United States on it, or the shield. And so this is a eagle of the United States above a picture of Robert E. Lee. So how does this complicate the message behind the statue? What would you use with this to discuss the reason this statue was built and how it was perceived in Richmond? Again, Richmond had a very large Black population. This was put in an area as Richmond was growing. This was put in a very white neighborhood, or what would become a very white, wealthy neighborhood. And so how does this affect where the statue was put, and what is the hypocrisy behind the eagle, the American eagle, with this picture of Robert E. Lee underneath it? And so we look at how these memories kind of grew. I mean, we look at how these memorials kind of were put up. A lot of these statues to the Confederate leaders were put up in states in the North, states in the South, but there were also statues that were put up to Black individuals. And this is actually one of the worst ones that I found, but it's fascinating to use within a classroom.
Can I interrupt you for just a minute, yeah, Alex? I'm sorry. I did want to address some of the connections that were brought up, not only in the Q&A, but just add a little bit more context to what you were saying. So somebody asked what happened to the Lee Jackson statue after it was taken down, or perhaps they were referring to the Confederate sailors and soldiers monuments. The latest that we are aware of is that these monuments are still existing in the possession of Baltimore City. But they are not on any live view or with any additional interpretation. So there have been certain statues or monuments that instead of being taken down, were given additional interpretation, but that did not happen with the four examples from Baltimore that came down in 2017. It's also worth mentioning that on the other side of Wyman Park, there is a statue to Union soldiers. Now, it is not as distinct, you know, with having the generals themselves. It's more of an abstract image, and we didn't have one in our collection. But if you were to look at that sort of investigation about how they are positioned within a similar public space, Wyman Park in Baltimore would be a good example of that. And I definitely encourage folks to check out the Union monument there as well. We did have a question, Alex, other than Talbot, are there counties in Maryland where the local government voted to preserve a monument to Confederate soldiers on public land? And what Michael is referring to there, this also one we don't address directly here, but I encourage you to check out the Talbot Boy statue that exists to Confederate veterans just outside of the courthouse in Easton. So not just public land, but a courthouse public land. And instead of taking it down, which was voted against multiple times, they chose to erect a statue to Frederick Douglass, a son of Talbot County, to create some sort of balance. So that was discussed in the virtual public program a few weeks back by Dr. Renee Ader, who we have that recording available for you in your package as well. But Talbot County, that is the main example that I'm aware of where the government voted to Wacomico County on the lower eastern shore, where a, not a statue, but a plaque to General Winder, who actually oversaw the Andersonville prison for some amount of time, that plaque was taken down out off of another public space in courthouse in Wacomico County. So if there are other examples, we definitely welcome those from folks in the chat, but you have a few examples like Talbot where it's preserved, and then Wacomico where a general from the Confederate side was taken down. So thank you for those questions. And Alex, I'll send it back to you. We are at 12:43, just a time reminder.
So this is a monument that was put up in South Carolina, and Confederate organizations didn't always put up monuments to Confederate leaders, but also monuments to enslaved individuals. But this is, I find this one fascinating, and I like using it. So the letter, we have the letter in our collection. I pulled the images off of the internet. But as you can see in the highlighted section, the lost cause mentality is seen here in corrupting the idea of enslavement, and stated that slaves were devoted to their owners with their own, while their owners fought for the principles of Confederate states. And the images on the sides are of a mammy, which was a term used for a Black woman who oversaw, who raised the children in a home, and then of an enslaved man in a field. But what's interesting about this, and this is where you can have some debate with students, is there's controversy over around whether this statue should be removed. The ancestors of the enslaved family view this as a monument to their family, but activists view it as rewriting slavery and a symbol of the lost cause. And so these types of sources are great to use in the classroom as it highlights the view the lost cause had on slavery and pushed the narrative of happy enslaved people. These monuments, again, serve the role of influencing the public to thinking the Confederacy was great and a stately place. So we're going to move on to literature, and I just want to talk a little bit about literature and music because of Maryland, My Maryland. So we can see these are some of the major songs that were in the Republic, Dixie, John Brown's Body, and Maryland, My Maryland. These were all major songs during the Civil War. Maryland, My Maryland is the state song of Maryland. It was written as a poem in 1861 by James Rydell Randall. Randall wrote this poem following the Pratt Street riots, and he was calling for Maryland to secede from the Union and to join the Confederacy. It was put to the music of O Tannenbaum, and it became a major song for the Confederacy. Robert E. Lee supposedly had this troop sing it when they marched into Frederick, Maryland. Oliver Wendell Holmes actually called this one of the most important songs to the Civil War, next to John Brown's Body, which was sung by United States Color Troops. Some of you might know the lyrics, but if you see on the first stanza, it says, "The despot's heel is on thy shore, his torch is at thy temple door." Randall is talking about union, and he's actually using this to try and get the Maryland to secede. And so this is a brings up a good idea of memory. A state like Maryland that has a very, very large Black population and a population that it has a lot of Northern tendencies, how is moralization of Confederate sympathy seen in Maryland today? How is this seen as a state symbol of Maryland? I should note there's currently debate in the Maryland legislature to get this song removed. Bills to remove the song have been put up, but many times they keep getting voted down. I also want to highlight, though, that there is actually a union version of Maryland, My Maryland. It was written in 1863. And you can see that the first stanza says, "The traitor's feet are on the shore. They walk the streets of Baltimore. They rose in mass not long ago. The Union swore to overthrow." So you can see that this actually takes Maryland, My Maryland, and puts it in discussing the Patriot Riot and the events that they that the Confederate sympathizers tried to do. So this is available. This is in our collection. You can find it at Duke has it on their website. But one thing that's great is using this next to the previous source within a classroom, and just kind of think about how these could work off of one another. But I want to move up to memory and activism today. And so
if I could just add on to the music piece just a little bit, Alex, the Maryland, My Maryland, to go along with the earlier point about connections to the Lost Cause and some of the later movements, Maryland, My Maryland was not established as a state song until 1939. So it was not, again, that immediate commemoration for lost soldiers, for example. It was a deliberate effort to bring that type of ideology and thought to the state identity. So that brings up some of the problematic elements of it. And it was, I believe it's now the 10th time that it has come to the legislature to remove that as the state song. It is very likely to happen this time around. The hearings just started in late February. And that's something for all of us to keep an eye on, and something even for your students to think about as how this history is still a contemporary conversation. And we may see those changes happening very soon. Just another quick mention, one of the items in the resource package that everybody should have received was a op-ed written by a Black Baltimorean, William Matthews, who basically provided a rebuttal to Maryland, My Maryland, saying it was an affront to those Black Baltimoreans and their achievements at that time. That was published in 1863. So there were contemporaries that presented a counterpoint to that.
So when we talk about memory going into like how it's seen today, this is a big debate, and one that discussing monuments and the history of monuments, especially Confederate monuments in your classroom, this topic is going to come up, activism today and memory today. So how are monuments interpreted in the world today? And then how can this be used to foster debate in the classroom? And I want to start with this image. This is an image of Mining the Museum, which was an exhibition by Fred Wilson at the Maryland Center for History and Culture. And Fred Wilson was a Black artist. He was allowed to go through our collection, and he addressed race in museum collections. He was given free range to the collection and aimed to show how traditionally white museums, like our institution was, what we collected and what stories we told and what we left out. And this is one example. The three busts on the right are Henry Clay, Andrew Jackson, and Napoleon Bonaparte, all without relation to Maryland. The three empty pedestals are labeled Harriet Tubman, Frederick Douglass, and Benjamin Banneker, who are all important Marylanders. The globe says truth in the middle. And so how can this be used to address equity of memory to students? And how can you present this image to your students? we like to use this to show that museums were a purveyor in this lost cause mentality. A lot of museums were like this. They only put white history out there. The monuments, there were no monuments to, there were not very many monuments to Black individuals in museums to challenge the lost cause narrative and to challenge the memory of the Confederacy. Now, this is our exhibit today, our Civil War exhibit called Divided Voices. So you can see that we have a lot more memory of different stories out there. So we have Harriet Tubman, we have Frederick Douglass, we have other individuals as well in there. So just to kind of say that we have changed and put new stories out there. But as an institution, we did have a Confederate room. And this is one of the cases from the Confederate room. It was a case to Maryland, My Maryland, and it was honoring Randall and what he wrote. And using this image, you can see how the state song became this bastion of many white individuals in Maryland, especially white individuals working in historical societies like we used to have. But I want to jump forward. I want to go back to this image as well, because this is the next two images are a great thing that you can use to talk about memory. And so we saw these images in metal commemorating the laying of the first stone in Richmond. And so we looked at how can this be used to discuss within your classroom today? What can you talk about today using this? When discussing Confederate monuments and their removal, what image could you place with this source? And one of the images that we want to place is this image right here. This is the statue, the Lee Monument in Richmond. You can see that following the murder of George Floyd and the resulting protest, it had been spray painted. You can see Black Lives Matter sprayed on it. You can see other symbols of the Black Lives Matter movement spray painted on it. And using this image next to the other one allows one to talk about the meaning of the statue when it was put up versus the meaning of it today. It also allows for the discussion of what is happening to the statue. And depending on the age of your students, you can get into the debate of, should you clean the statue and leave it up? Should you take it down and leave the pedestal? Or should you leave it up with interpretation? How do you address this? And so one of the, closer to home, one thing that was taken down was in 1947, the Baltimore City Recreation Commission designated a park in Baltimore, General Robert E. Lee Park. The naming was done by Elizabeth Garrett White, who was the aunt of a ardent segregationist, Robert Garrett. After Elizabeth died, she required that the proceeds of the sale of her estate go to the construction of a Robert E. Lee monument in Baltimore. But her nephew decided that it should be used to name a park as he was on the board of Baltimore City Parks and Recreation. So this was taken down, the park was renamed. But what's interesting is, what does this tell us about the power of memory in the decades following the Civil War? Who had the power? Who could put monuments up? Who took them down? And then, so those kind of questions can be used in the classroom. But memory even exists all the way up to today. And it didn't always exist in statues. This is a publication from 1997 by the Sons of Confederate Veterans. And they sued the Maryland Vehicle Administration over the MVA revoking their Sons of Confederate license plate. Despite being 133 years after the end of the Civil War and the beginning of the Lost Cause movement, you can see in this red square the same tropes that were used to justify the Confederate flag being on their license plate. They have a section called "As We See It," and in there you see the Civil War versus war between the states. They address whether Lincoln was a good president, whether what he did in Baltimore is constitutional. So that it's really this lost cause manifested into a book. But when using this with your students, what's important to highlight is that the lost cause mentality is still exists in modern thinking. I do want to highlight that I grew up outside of Memphis, Tennessee, and growing up in elementary, middle school, I did hear some lost cause tropes being taught to me. So it is a more modern thing than many students think about. This can also be used to address how Confederacy still plays a role in the lives of many today, especially following the January 6th event at the Capitol and the Confederate flag seen at the event. And this is still being, this court case is actually still happening today. There's still a lot of debate over whether Confederate flags should be on license plates. I do want to highlight, though, that in more recent decades, monuments going up to Black soldiers, specifically only to the Black soldiers, have been put up. And this is the African American Civil War Memorial in Washington, D.C., part of the African American Civil War Museum. It lists the names of 209,145 United States color troops who fought for their freedom during the Civil War. And it commemorates the African American soldiers and sailors who fought for the Union. So in recent decades, as Confederate monuments have been coming down, more monuments commemorating the experience of Black individuals have been going up. But one kind of thing I want to end on is, we talked a lot about Confederate monuments, and how do we address monuments that are not Confederate monuments, but are monuments to famous individuals who own slaves? This is a monument in the Mount Vernon area of Baltimore to John Edgar Howard. John Edgar Howard, he owned the land that Mount Vernon is built on. He was a Revolutionary War general, but he was also a slave owner. And are his past accomplishments outweighed by his role as a slave owner? This is a photo I took during a 2020 George Floyd protest following his death. And you can see that protesters thought differently. This was a protest that was led by students at the Baltimore School for the Arts. Now, I don't know if they were the ones who spray painted. I don't know who spray painted the color, the slave owner, rest in peace, George, on it. But you can see that the debate on does one owning enslaved individual outweigh their accomplishments? And this is a debate you can have in your classroom. And one thing I want to have you think about is, what would you do to facilitate this debate in this conversation? What images might you use? What statues might you use? And so we're coming to the end, but we just wanted to provide some sources on how we might use monuments and memory when we're working with students, and give you some ideas on how you might be able to use it as well. And one thing we do want to highlight is that David did moderate a conversation with Renee Ader and Dr. Billy Coleman on and Ada Pinkston on monuments and memory and memorialization. And that can be found on YouTube. It can also be found on our website as well. Dave, do you want to jump in and say kind of anything about that?
Sure. I mean, that would be a great supplemental resource, I think, for educators to take on ahead of time. I don't know that necessarily you want to provide it directly to your students. That link and description is also available in the resource package that everybody should have received as a Google Drive share. Dr. Renee Ader, in particular, we also highlighted her website and project, Monuments to the Slave Past. So she's really working on seeing where kind of the counterpoint to either monuments to the Confederacy or to white supremacy at large are being developed or reinterpreted around the country. So definitely a wonderful resource there. And moving through, Alex, we'll try to get through as much as we can here in our remaining couple minutes while folks stick with us. But each summer, we offer a week-long Institute for Continuing Education credit, the themes of slavery, freedom, and memory. So we'll build on and provide additional resources around topics like we're discussing today. We will be announcing and opening up registration for that experience very soon, so keep an eye out. And if you are not on our educator e-newsletter list, please sign up for that through our website and you'll get the up-to-date announcements there. As far as some of the resources that are readily available, again, all of this is outlined in the resource package that you received by email, but we have the Black Freedom Struggle video lesson package looking at before, during, and after the Civil War, how many of these dynamics developed. These are packages that include lesson plans, accompanying videos from the exhibition, and suggested activities that you can implement with your students. And you can schedule and receive that package as well through our website. Some of the resources that we also have available, our Historical Investigations Portal is a digital curriculum that's free for all educators to access. You may be in a county that has HIP linked in through your learning management system. So definitely check that out to have that integrated. But the links are also publicly available. A couple of lessons I wanted to highlight: was the Dred Scott decision legally correct? Civil War, Maryland, martial law in Baltimore, both address how some of these historical figures and or the representations of them are applied in the historical context and leading students through an investigation of that. One thing I just learned earlier today, Alex, and for our participants, March 6th is actually the anniversary of the Dred Scott decision in 1857. So we are coincidentally on a day looking at when Maryland native Justice Taney made that decision in the Dred Scott case. So very significant how you connect a Marylander to the national context there. We also have a virtual field trip that's a live interactive experience from our studio at MCHC. The program I wanted to highlight was Reacting to Freedom, Diverse Opinions in Reconstruction Era Maryland. So looking at, again, primary source perspectives from an array of individuals, which really gives you a sense of how diverse Maryland was in terms of who was represented and how they sought to preserve that sort of memory in the immediate post-war period. And then other resources, again, outlined in your PDF package that should be available to everyone. Many of these resources you might be familiar with already and that link into some of the slides and content we talked about today, but related to the state song and the advisory group that analyzed it, again, a contemporary conversation that's still ongoing, as well as the removal and research efforts behind the monuments in Baltimore, the four that were removed several years ago. A really great context from Baltimore Heritage, as well as the city commission that was established to study and then make recommendations about those monuments. So a lot that you can dig into to learn more about those particular instances.
We did get a question about will a recording be available, and yes, it will be. It will be sent out either next week or the week after to you all.
Absolutely. So for all of our participants today, as well as those that weren't able to join us live, the recording will be made available relatively soon. That will include a reminder about the document package. Some folks asked about the slides that were made available. We don't typically make the full presentation available. However, if there was a particular slide, a resource like the 1860 census map that was mentioned, please feel free to follow up with us. We can also attach that to the follow-up email if it's something that would be useful for classroom instruction. So we are at 104. I want to respect everybody's time, especially on a Saturday. Really appreciate you spending this time with us and learning and also offering some of your knowledge about these examples and others and how they can be applied in the classroom. Again, just a reminder that all of our public programs and professional development from the Maryland Center for History and Culture are coming to you free. And part of the way we're able to provide that is through the support of our members and other supporters. So definitely consider joining or donating to allow us to continue to do this great work. I do want to highlight a few upcoming programs that link into the content we're talking about today. On April 8th, I will be moderating and leading a discussion with several members of the Maryland Lynching Truth and Reconciliation Commission. That's a public program. Registration is available through our website to get a look at the first commission established in the country to look at and find reconciliatory efforts related to the lynching victims within Maryland. We'll also be conducting a accompanying teacher workshop on April 24th, similar to what we had today, looking at specific primary resource collections that can support your ability to look at another really challenging topic, lynching and racial terror efforts within the classroom with your students. We'll be joined by our colleagues from the Reginald F. Lewis Museum to conduct that workshop on April 24th. So again, keep an eye out for all of our public programs and resources to support instruction at mdhistory.org. So have a wonderful rest of your weekend. And we hope to engage with you soon through the Maryland Center for History and Culture. Thanks, everyone.